Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I am joined, this is, like I say, I always like to peel back the curtain on my podcast. This is took a couple of days to set up. Not only has my guest been unwell, I have actually had a bit of a sore throat the last couple of days as well. So I was quite glad when we held it off for a couple of days. But I'm joined by the, I call you the leader of the pack in community pro wrestling.
I would probably say I'm up there with Rex, so but we're all equal. But I would, if you want to call me the leader of the pack, you bar in.
Right, okay.
You do that.
I'll take the issue if Rex has one with it. So the leader of the pack, it's JTT. Welcome to the show.
How you doing, mate? All right.
Not too bad. But yeah, glad we finally got this one set up. And we've got you in the book for season six.
Nick Griffiths and being no well about the flu, I am kind of feeling a wee bit better. But again, when do you ever feel better? So,
aye. This time of year as well, it's dark when you start work, dark when you leave, and it's just like a dour time. I mean, it's supposed to be the happiest time of year, Christmas and everything, but I'll be arsed, to be honest. I'm just like, oh, God. I work from home, so it's not even like I have to go anywhere particularly.
You've got a cheek to moan.
I know. I'm in my own house, sorry about my stuff, and here I'm whinging about the weather and all that. I don't have to actually leave the house at all, unless the dog starts scraping the walls, trying to.
You can go out. Sit there in your jammy bottoms with a respectable top on, and you're cool.
You say that. I am actually wearing a respectable top and my joggers, and I'm the wiser if the team's call comes. So yeah, welcome to the show. You've got someone that listens to the show, as you've told me before, which is nice. It's nice to have, nice to know who the five people that listen are.
It's got me through many a night shift, to be fair, sticking it on, and we sometimes listening and then re-listening, so aye.
I'll take that. I'm surprised I haven't made you fall asleep during your shifts, but I'll take it as a compliment anyway that you're re-listening at least. The other thing is we have briefly, for almost a split second, have met the Community Pro Wrestling show in Peterhead.
Yes, we met.
That was a very odd day for me because I spoke to so many people. It was like, I think by the time the main event guys like yourself came out after the show, I was like, oh, my social battery's just dead now. I'm just
You must have been drained because was it not a long drive that day for yourself as well?
Not really. Peterhead to Elgin. It's about an hour 20, if that. But yeah,
we were like 8-9 hour round trip, so we never got back to Glasgow to probably about 1-2 in the morning after that show. So
yeah,
it was longer.
I can't moan about that either. So that's my I'm nearly to moan in this podcast. It seems. That's fine. Everything's got in context. It's not that bad, really. Anyway, so we'll go back to the start then. The usual question everyone gets asked on this podcast for the first time: how did you get into wrestling? So, what was the moment that got you hooked on pro wrestling?
So, when I was at school, around about 14, 15, my friends came in and they were talking about this thing called wrestling. I hadn't really watched or heard about it before then, and I got myself hooked into it from there. And it was like, I think it was like Attitude Era just started, so it was probably the best era to get into wrestling. You know, everything was just outlandish. The storylines were crazy, and I was kind of hooked to then on. You know, forced my dad to get Sky back when Sky was like so cheap and there was not many channels on it, you know. Mm-hmm. And then Channel 4 had dipped her toe in, showing like pay-per-views and I think Sunday Night Heat, wasn't it?
It was, yes. I remember it well.
About 99, 2000 was when I got into it, when I was about 16, 14, 15, 16, right about that era. So, aye. And I would probably say that's probably the best era, still to this date.
So See, I can see why people say that, and that's when I got in as well. So that's why I got into wrestling. It was around about the Channel 4 time. That's Andy Peters has got a lot to answer for wrestling fans of our age, because that's why people got into it.
Oh.
So yeah, some eras I like more than others. Attitude probably doesn't age as well, but certainly for its time, absolutely. It was the characters that, like, it's the ones where you sat down and you'd watch it. Your mum would come in and it'd be Val Venus doing innuendos and trying to have his way with Godfather's hose or something. You're just like,
to be fair, my dad would join us every Monday night when we watched it. So that's what kind of, it was kind of our bond, if you know what I mean. So my friend along the road, my friend Brian, he would come along and we'd sit anticipating this wrestling show to come on. And my dad would come in, he would join us, he would sit and watch. So we'd call ourselves, this is what it sounds lame, but we'd be like Expat, Road Dog and Billy Gunn. That's what we'd kind of call ourselves. So I was a big Road Dog and Billy Ass Gunn back in the days, fan back in the day, you know.
Hey, I mean, not a bad one to go for, because, well, Billy Gunn, he's still going. He's still going at a high level, which is ridiculous.
And he's, what, 60? 55, 60? I don't know.
I'm going to check, just in case, for whatever reason, he is listening, just so we don't offend the man. 60, 60.
60, Jesus. I don't think I'll still be going at 60.
I definitely will be looking like that at 60. Jeez, he's an absolute beast of a man. Wow. Anyway, so sorry, I just lost myself in Billy Gunn there for a moment. So it's 14, 15, 16. So you got in at a teen time. That's kind of a time where you would, nowadays, that's when you kind of look to try and get into wrestling if you're wanting to do it. So was there any thoughts at that point, or was you just enjoyed watching it and doing maybe some backyarding?
Nah, just enjoyed watching it, to be fair. And probably, like everybody says, it was like hard to get into back in the days. So I never really looked into it. And I probably couldn't have looked into it. I wouldn't have. 100%, nah. Nah, when I got into it, it was like later on, yeah, as we'll get into the podcast.
I mean, I suppose at that time, like you're saying, it was difficult. I think if you're wanting to be a wrestler at that time, you would want to go down to wherever it is, Hammerlock or wherever it is, down south, if you wanted to see wrestling, or the infamous back of the post office with Jake Snake Roberts, if you wanted to do it up here.
I've heard all the stories about this post office and stuff like that. I was quite happily just watching wrestling, to be fair.
Mm-hmm.
Never had any back then to delve into the internet or the rabbit hole and look into becoming a professional wrestler. I probably didn't even realise it was a thing. I was like everybody else, like, this is a big thing in America. You need to be jacked, you need to be on steroids and all that carry on. I probably had that thought back then as a 14, 15-year-old boy, you know what I mean?
So you said you knew the Outlaws, yourself and your pal and your dad. Who are your other favourites? Was there anyone that you had to see every week if you could when they came on?
Austin Rock. Austin Rock was the kind of storyline that kept me going back for years. Everybody was a character.
That's the best thing. It's like, it's one of those times you can go back and go, like, my favourites were the Hardy Boys. They were always my favourites, but had I loved Too Cool.
Turned out to be one of the best tag teams ever. Still gone to this day, you know what I mean? Yeah. Everybody. I like to, so, like, obviously when I found that the kind of Attitude Era, I like to kind of delve back. So, like, back in the Hulk Hogan days, the Mr. Perfect, stuff like that. So I kind of delve back into that. I loved Mr. Perfect. I thought he was class. but I for the Attitude Era, like, every storyline just kept you gripped. doesn't matter what it was, whether it was me young getting buffed to a hand or, you know, just stupid things, but then the serious stuff as well. So I would say just the full attitude there, that everybody in it was like noticeable and you knew who they were, you know what I mean? Because of the storylines, everybody had a storyline from the bottom of the card to the top of the card, and it was just gripping every week.
Absolutely. So from that point onwards then, were you a big collector? Was just, again, was just the watching, or were you a magazine guy? Were you a figures guy, video games?
I would get the odd magazine now and again. I would get the odd video tape, remember, you know, cassette tapes, you know, they don't exist anymore. showing my age. And figures, I was never a big fan of collecting. Never a big fan of games and see like your PlayStations and stuff like that. I know it came out later, but I was never a fan of gaming. Never. Back when when I was that age, it was like Spectrums and Ataris, if you remember them. Used to take ages to load. So I was never a fan. I could never, it's still to this very day, I'm not really a gamer fan. I don't sit and play the games and stuff like that. It was never my thing.
All right. I think we're just like, again, most of the people that I've spoken to are that I've come into the age where video games are more prominent. But I suppose you're coming in just as they were starting, and you were a little bit older at the time. So it wouldn't have been your thing. You were probably, I don't know, what people were into, football or whatever at that time.
Yep. So I wasn't really a big gamer fan, and even to this day, like you say, this is like the era. I still can't sit down. I don't know if I've not got the patience, but I just can't sit in front of the screens and play video games. It's just not my thing. And I probably get a lot of heat for that, but I just don't like them playing video games.
I mean, I wish I had the time. Nowadays, that's dinner. I keep sitting down to play a game, and it's just, I can't be arsed. It's nowadays, back in our day, even though it took ages to load, you didn't have to deal with anything like patches or a couple gigabytes of downloading and that. You just put the disc in, that was it, you're ready to go. And every time I load up a PS4, it just goes, oh, update, turn it off then, I'm done. I'm me.
Yeah. Don't get me wrong, I've probably spent quite a lot of money on PlayStations and PlayStation games for my son, so I know what they are, I just don't have time for them. When anybody gets it wrong.
So from that point onwards then, it's you're into the wrestling. Was there ever a break, or were you always just in?
So I got not to delve into my life, but I got married pretty young, and then I kind of had a break then, and it wasn't like till 2015 again before I kind of connected back into wrestling. So there was a break, there was a break where I never really watched anything, to be fair. I never even delved in for clips on YouTube or delved into rabbit holes watching wrestling again. So there was a big break from probably 2015. Is when I kind of got back into it again.
Is that just one of those moments where you decide that right, I'm married now, I'm a grown up, I don't need this this wrestling stuff? Because I'm sure we've all wavered.
I wouldn't say I've grown up at 21, but it was kind of life took over. My boy was born when I was 21 as well, so life kind of took over. You know, you got to pull on your big boy pants, get a job, take on a house, keep a woman happy. It was life, we'll call it, Billy, life.
I was just going to say, that last one's a full-time job, am I right, lads? Ha, 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 ha.
Isn't it half?
I know. I'm saying that. My wife does listen, so it's fine. I understand that, especially, I mean, I know myself, I've banged on about it in every episode, I think. If I'm not mentioning WrestleZone, I'm mentioning that I'm a dad now. But yeah, I absolutely understand that. Like that first couple of months anyway, certainly there's no time for anything. You're just hoping and praying for sleep at that point. I was anyway. Still am some days. So you came back in 2015. Was the thing that caught your eye then that brought you back?
It was my friend was going to a show in the garage. You'll know what company it is. And he'd phoned and asked, he had a spare ticket that he knew I was kind of into wrestling as a kid, and asked me, did I want to go? I wasn't really doing anything, so I thought, I'll go. I obviously went to that show at the time and got the bug for that company. And that's when it kind of reignited again.
That was just after the documentary as well, or at least the second one, I think it was.
Yeah, I think one eye.
So that was a big time to get back into it, certainly, especially at a local level. So I'm assuming WWE or whoever else came probably just in with that as part of the package. Then you're back into it. But was it the local scene that you're just like, right, there's stuff here now. I need to find out more about it.
So I would say that 2015, I kind of looked back on like clips and stuff like that, but WWE wasn't really pulling me in. So the local scene, ICW, was where I kind of thought, I'm going to go to these shows, because they, again, it reminded me of ECW back in the day. Crazy storylines, mad wrestling. It hooked me. It got me hooked, to be fair. Got to that ICW show that night, got me hooked.
Was there anyone on that card that you remember that from
Jesus.
Matches? I know I'm testing your memory here when it comes to it, but anyone at all, just so I can kind of get a gauge maybe of the time or even the event.
Was it when Drew McIntyre returned? I'm trying to think.
All right, okay. So after it wasn't the show he actually returned at, wasn't that? It was the ABC, something like that, I can't remember.
He turned up at ABC. This was a show at the garage. I can't really remember the card. But it was round about that era. When he returned 2015, 2016, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. Yeah. This is absolutely derailing, but I'm gonna at least have the shows up to see. If there's not that many, then we can good stab at it. But I know that ICW like to run monthly, which is good for people watching. It's not great for me trying to find the results because they're like hen's teeth. I still get them though. Watch it. Right. So, Insane Invasion Championship Wrestling. You sound interesting. Interspecies Wrestling. Oh, I don't like cage match. Cage match creep me out now.
You're delving into something different.
I'm just the Germans. Just the Germans. It's 44 matches. 44 shows. I'm gonna go through one by one. Right. A few in Glasgow. Right, okay, we'll just move on. So yeah, Drew was back there. So at least there was at least one recognizable face for you, mm-hmm. then, I'm guessing. So yeah, so at least
you was chosen one era, wasn't it? Before that, when he was the chosen one, Intercontinental Champion, and then obviously let go, came back, and kind of turned Scottish wrestling, UK wrestling on its head.
So you're one of the few people that missed the MB. Era then, that would have been if you got out just as he was still kind of chosen one and came back for him his big run in the UK Indies.
I'm not going to lie, I've seen clips. It was Jinder Mahal with a cast, was it?
I think Drew had the cast, yeah. And Jinder Mahal, as Eva Marie once called him. It was a time. It was a wonderful time for. Well, for me, anyway, hilarious. That's the sort of hokey crap I like. Anyway, I love the Highlanders. Highlanders were my jam, even though nobody else seemed to like them. So 2015, then you're back into the wrestling again. Was there any bug at that point to think, right, there's a local scene here, maybe I can give this a go?
So it took about a year. I was at a show. Don't ask me the show. I can't remember. I seen. Somebody wearing, it was like kind of silent, t-shirt or a GPWA t-shirt. And that's when I looked into Glasgow Pro Wrestling Asylum, basically, the GPWA, and seen that you could sign up to be a wrestler. And at the ripe old age of 31, 32, I thought, this is something I need to give a bash, you know. So I signed up to it.
It's one of those things, I suppose. Yeah, like saying, you'll get to down the line at Billy Gunn's age, and you'll sit there and go, I wish I tried it at least once, you know. So it was just a never never. If you went in and hurt yourself first session, you're like, well, at least I gave it a go, kind of thing. Was that the mentality?
It was one of the things that I had to try, but it was a niggling, like, can I do this? I've watched this for long enough when I was a kid. Can I go back into it? Is the scene that's booming at that time, could I do this? You know, so I genuinely had to get a try. I probably still can't do it to this date, but...
I mean, that's a good while ago then. So that's, what, seven years from your first session?
8 years.
8 years. Yeah, 2016 to now. So yeah, but coming up to 8 years anyway. Certainly, if not on it. So that's a big gap. The time was I remember. I think Gravy Davey put up a post about your kind of journey on and off wrestling. Was it always GPWA for a point? What was your kind of training history?
GPWA 2016. They do like an induction, and then they do like a second induction, and then you go into main classes. So I think all in all, I trained there probably to the start of 2017. And then this is where Ravi gets it mixed up. I'd done absolutely hee-haw training, nothing. That might have wanted to go into girders once or twice, and I wasn't feeling it, if you know what I mean. I had things going on in my life that were derailing me, so to speak. So I it was GPWA for about 8 months to the January, and then 2017, 2018, I kind of dipped my toe, gone back in, doing an induction, no feeling it again. And then going to girders, I think I went to girders maybe two or three times, and again, I just wasn't for me, I think, at that time in my life.
So yeah, just real life is just needing to settle before you'd properly tried again. Mm-hmm. The bug never left. Then it was always there. It's just a case of everything else needed to calm down before it would. You needed a bit of silence before you could actually try it. One more time.
Aye, and it's this last year, so I've been training a year at Review School. This last year's probably been the year that, if I was to put all the years and tell you everything that happened in the years between the training, this year you'd go, really? That's what happened and you're still doing it? So this is probably one of the worst years in terms of things happening, like my dad passed and stuff like that. And then to put them into context with training at GPWA, things that happened this year has probably been worse than what happened during GPWA. So, but I'm still here, mm-hmm. still training.
I suppose one of those things that if you watch, we will do some. We'll talk about other things. So we'll kind of try and curtail the serious chat, because this podcast isn't very good at serious chat anyway. But I suppose one of those things, if you say it's the worst year and your dad passing away, if he's the guy that kind of helped you get into wrestling way back when in the Attitude Era, then at this point, it's one of those things where is it a way that you're doing it kind of on like for him? I suppose now it's like, well, he got me into this. Now I'm going to push on forward and do this, because without him, maybe I wouldn't be actually watching it and getting into it.
That's probably one thing I don't want to touch on.
That's fine. That's cool. We'll move on. Don't worry about it.
I probably I'm doing it just mm-hmm. to just for not for him, but you get what I mean.
That's fine. That. Cool. Let's move on. That's all right. Right. Okay. Cool things. Happy stuff. Wrestling. Don't know if all those are encompassing, but so Ravy Davies School, course opened, and were you pretty much first through the door? Was it just a case of you, did you know Davy beforehand, or
I obviously trained with Davy in GPWA, so I knew of him. I think it was last year. I don't know how I got into it, but it was my partner at the time had said, "Oh, look, Ravy Davies opened a wrestling school," and I was staying in Rossie, so you can imagine the travel that I had at the time from Rossie to Govan. But I was still doing it, so I said, "I'm going to give this a bash. I know Ravy. I know he'll probably know who I am." Or there's this ongoing joke that back in the GPWA days, I was the guy that thought wrestling was real. I don't know where they got this from. They're probably laughing at me this and sees this. So I think I was 4 weeks into it opening before I joined. Yeah, probably 4 weeks.
And was there just a comfort? I suppose there'll be a comfort level straight away because Davey will know you and you'll know him. Was it as soon as you went in, you're like, right, this is where I need to be.
It was a case of walking in. I said, "All right, Davey." He said, "How you doing, John?" So he obviously still knew who I was. Sam Barber was there. He obviously still knew who I was because I trained with Sam back in GPWA. So it was a comfort level. It was a different vibe, if you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, yeah. I mean, if you spent the last couple of years dipping your toe in and it's been in front of, I mean, faces you'll know, but they won't know you. At least you know the people that you're with will kind of push you to your limits and maybe push you a little further, but they're doing it. You know them, kind of thing. Like I say, the different vibe at the same time. It's like your mates. Your mates will make you maybe do a little bit further, go a little bit further than you possibly want to. But it's for, hopefully for all the right reasons, usually anyway. So from that point onwards, you're in GPW, sorry, not. You're in Ravy Davies' Glasgow School of Wrestling.
Glasgow School of Wrestling.
Can't mix up the two, or I'll have Davey at the door, along with Rex. This could be a very busy day. But from that point onwards, when did you, did it come back to you quite quickly, like the bits you'd learned, you trained? Because it must have not been that far along where you started and then you were on shows.
So I started in the November last year. Obviously, taking a bump again was kind of the realization that this is still sore. But other than that, everything else just kind of came. Like, I remember doing this. I remember how to do that. You know, it's like kind of riding a bike again. And I made my debut in April. Peterhead against two of my favourite wrestlers to wrestle against Ross and Darrow.
But I do have a noted, thank God, cage match. You showed me interspecies wrestling as an option, but you got this right. April 2023, debut in Peterhead.
Yes.
So that's a fair trek to go for your first ever match. I'm assuming you did things like crew maybe beforehand, so you kind of caught the vibe of the audience that Ravy Davies somehow gets in.
I think my first crew show was January in Johnston. Obviously, as you say, you've got to pay your dues in this game. So doing crew, doing anything I could to help out, govern shows, just like waiting for the time when Ravy Tom says, "You're ready," basically. It's time for your debut.
I don't know what it is about them. Davies shows, but the crowd are some of the wildest I've ever seen, and they're under 16. So it was Peterhead, so a little bit further up, the crowd's probably not as rabid, although they are, because I found out earlier this year that they are terrifying. So seeing the crowd, making your debut, was there any thought behind who you're going to be, who JTT was, the kind of style you're going for? Was the pack always kind of in the back of your mind, or around about?
Originally my debut was with Draven. Me and him tagged, and he had this idea of the pack, and wanted me to, like, we kind of tagged. So I was just like, my character's just like a bad guy, original bad guy. There's no essence, but like just a bad guy. That was the thing by my character, and it's kind of stuck with that. Boo me, cheer me, don't care. Bad guy, end of the day. Although I'm starting to get cheered sometimes now, so.
It's one of those things, like, there's no nuance to JTT. It's going to come out in all black and just batter someone for a bit and then leave again.
Yeah. Old school. Leather someday, up the road. So
was there any, so when you go back and watch, you say you don't particularly down for sitting down and watching things any long form or anything like that, but was there any wrestlers that you went, right, okay, I'm going to pick a bit out of that guy, I'm going to maybe use some of that as well, or was it just a case of, right, I've got it in my head, out, batter, leave, was that just that it?
So I want to say, like, do you remember, obviously I remember Big Boss Man,
mm-hmm.
back when he was, like, no dressed as the police, but he was dressed, like, in the SWAT gear type, black, just come in, bought somebody with a nightstick and left. Just that kind of character, just come in, wrestle, bought somebody and leave, you know? There's no great thinking behind it, to be fair. Some of the characters you see these days are outlandish and, like, crazy, and they work. I just wanted to keep it simple. Like, my name is, like, my initials, so JTT. Just keep it simple.
Right, well, I hope the Boss Man things you had to kind of clear some with Eli Bulwark, just to make sure that it was all safe. So, the pack then. So when I first saw you, it was Peterhead, the return. You returned to Peterhead and you started adding more to your ranks. I think it was Thorin Thermite you added on that particular evening in August. So it was yourself, Rex, Draven, and then adding as you go. Do you have a particular thing you look for when it comes to adding to the pack? Or is it just a case of, if you've battered them enough, you go, it's like Pokemon, I'll just catch you and just we'll just add you to the crew here.
I would go with that one. I just if we see that you can fight and, like, you want to be part of a crew that wants to fight, we'll introduce you to the gang. So we'll go, like, as you say, Thor and Rex, myself. We tagged now. We've tagged for quite a while. I think we've tagged since May. So we tag. You've got Draven. And sometimes we'll go Jinx, who was on, like, Student SmackDown and Tarbert Show, joined the ranks. So we dabble. You just don't know who's going to turn in the pack, you know what I mean? You just don't know who's going to show up with, just to fight the Govern team.
The Govern team or Termination Z or just whoever's there. So you made your debuts, like I said, April. There was one show CPW. How have I got CPW in my head? CPW that I've got in mind, which is the Helensburgh show.
Yes.
Which, of course, was quite notable because there was someone in the front row by the name of Rab Florence, famed wrestling podcaster, does nothing else. do you feel any, like, nerves when you come into the wrestling, and does it get heightened when you know someone who's got quite a big following could be quite vocal, whether it's good or bad as well? Is there any additional nerves for that?
No, he's just a fan come to watch wrestling. Excuse me. just a fan coming to watch wrestling. Obviously, he had a part in the show. But no, I walked in the ring, seen him sitting there, no nerves at all. In fact, I think I took his wee daughter's hammer and flung it away. So, no, no nerves at all. No. I thought I'd be very nervous. I was nervous in my first match. But the nerves kind of go away. The nerves are behind the curtain. As soon as you get the curtain, it changes. It's like you're changing persona into a different person.
I don't know if that maybe comes with age as well, because I've spoken to quite a few wrestlers that have started a little bit later. Daisy Jenkins is always one that I bring up, but I know there's a couple guys down in Andy Roberts' school that are starting a little bit later in years, and there seems to be a maturity level that comes with that, because they've had the real life experience for the last however many years as well. So when the wrestling happens, this is they're actually just blowing off some steam. This is the bit where they get to relax. May not be the right word, but they get to relax for a couple hours because they've done the work. They've done the real life work while these young kids are tossing about and playing their video games, and you've been out grafting, and then you're coming to let off some steam by battering someone instead. do you feel like you do bring a little bit more of a maturity to your maybe outlook at wrestling because you started so further along?
I would say so. I just don't get nervous. Sometimes I'll get a wee twinge of nerves, and I don't know if it's maybe because I'll be facing a different team that I don't know, and trying to remember spots and moves and stuff like that. But I just don't get them anymore. And I think, as you say, as a maturity thing that I'm of later years in life, I've lived a life, and nerves just don't seem to affect me.
I think you get to about 30 and then you just go, what's the worst that can happen at this point, you know? whatever happens, I'll just move on. I've blown a spot. Ah, well, nobody noticed. It'll be fine. Move on. Next one kind of thing. It's just, it's not a don't give an attitude, but at the same time, it's like, we've been here long enough now to know that it's really not the end all of the world at this point. Let's just get to the next bit. Right. We'll get to the, because we mentioned your age. We'll just get rid of the questions that we've got going about them.
I want who's hanging these questions, but I can power them or part of them. And
I haven't written down the ones through Instagram because honestly, I got quite a few, but I definitely remember Thorn Thermite was one asking how old you were. But the worst one, it's James Blair. Old school cool James Blair has asked.
Best of them.
Was he present during the Ten Commandments?
I mean, me and Jesus wrote them. I can't, do you know what? Just fire away with the questions. They're all going to be age-related, right? Because I'm an old man. So I'll help Davey sometimes at the school. And there's a 5 to 11-year-old class, and they've got this thing now where they go, "You're okay, old man," and they just say it the full class. The class is like 2 hours long, and these wee guys will just hit it with us every 2 minutes. "You're okay, old man," and I'm just like, "I'm all right." So the age thing is just.
So we'll skip that. We did have an Allison. Message to was actually a bit of a 2-point. It called you a menace at first, and then just said, "Well, you're one of the sweetest with the kids' classes." So I don't want to make that the narrative here, because you're JTT and you're part of the pack, and you don't want to be known as the sweetest sweetheart.
My sweet side.
It's only because you can't really batter them without some sort of repercussions. I mean, once they're in the main class, that's it. Nice.
Oh, once
he's gone.
A wee bit and all.
James Blair also added, and when you want him battered.
James Blair, is that him calling me out on your podcast?
It seems to be.
Anytime. James Blair knows that the Pat's always got my back. So if he wants to mess with the Pat, he's messing with five or sixes, you know. Who's he got?
Like Ruby, I think that's about it.
Probably, aye.
I mean, that might cover a couple of years, to be honest. She's a bit scary.
one or two, but me and Rex will be there to clean up the mess, put it to bed.
So outside of CPW, of course, you have ventured elsewhere.
Yes.
Attitude Pro Wrestling debut September, I think it was, as a brand new team, as the Unwanted.
Yep.
Which is the Pack, but just 2 years. I don't know if there was an issue there or there was a reason why.
Yes, you start seeing the Pack. So me and Rex decided that we'd call ourselves a tag name as well. So we represent the Pack, the Unwanted, you know. So we're still part of the Pack, but as a re-tag, we represent the Pack as the Unwanted. And it's just, nay, it's just, we're still the Pack, you know what I mean?
It's so you can put out two t-shirts, isn't it, at the merch stand. You got your the Pack t-shirts and you got the Unwanted. Just double that merch money.
Once you get them to print, that's the whole. You've got to make some kind of earner as well. September, was that Rugby Slam?
Would have been, yes. So that's venturing outside of CPW, mm-hmm. but also kind of still within, because of course the Wanderer as a heavy hand in those shows. Was,
yes.
I don't think that was your first show out with CPW, but I always like getting in front of a kind of newer audience, for lack of a better term.
Brother Glenn is crazy. Absolute crazy. Brilliant crowd. The Glen Cairn Club is a nice wee packed venue. Really, really good. One of my favourites to wrestle in is the Glen Cairn. So take note, Mikey.
Well, I've got, was it Ruggie Rumble next year?
Yep, Rumble's coming up. Don't know what's on the horizon for that.
I think I've seen the matches that we announced so far. You got Luke King Sharp and Judas Grey, which is a match that I'm wanting to, once it goes up on the old YouTube, that'll be first thing I'm watching, because it's a long way to go. That's it. I'm skint. I've got a child to feed and me to feed, and I'm a fat man. But no, I'm loving seeing these shows back as well on social media, which, you know, back in ye olde days ourselves, VHS, if you wanted to watch a show and if you didn't see it, well, you never saw it. So it's so cool you've got these avenues to do it now. So yeah, the other one is a totally brand new crowd then, so it's Target. So yes. that was September 2023 as well. Quite a big month for you.
Yeah. Target, we were part of a six-man, so it might be Rex, but Rex was out injured at the time, so we recruited Nathan Oliver, who's an R member of the Pack. No bond to fight Nathan Oliver. Me and him and Katia, you know, the girl with the Russian gimmick.
Mm-hmm.
We fought against some of their wrestlers. So, really good venue. Crowd-wise, really good as well. We got a reaction, even though I don't know if anybody knew who we were. We obviously knew we were the bad guys. But I really enjoyed Target. Really enjoyed Target.
It's one of those things where, I mean, we talked about nerves and vibes as well. And we're talking about, like Ravy Davies School, you got the vibe there. And, of course, Attitude Pro Wrestling is a little bit of an extension of that, because The Wanderer does quite a lot for CPW as well. But Target's mm-hmm. pretty brand new as far as that goes. So,
In terms of nerves, that's probably one of the times I did get a wee kind of tingle. You're working with a new team, you don't know how they work, you don't know their stuff, you've no kind of done your background check, so to speak, because you don't know who you're wrestling until you get down there. But it went really, really well. I enjoyed the match. working with the guys we worked with, one of them had a belly gimmick, really, really funny. I thoroughly enjoyed working doing the Target.
So this is your what? First, not even your first year in the old wrestling business, and you've really packed in quite a bit. Not only with the debut, of course, the traveling up and down the country because of the way that CPW seem to be operating. You could appear anywhere at the moment, any venue, big or small, low or high, when it comes to the ceiling. Which
CPW show, sell it and have the best time of your life.
To be honest, I had a riot at the Beerhead one. It was just wild because you guys were I just caught the end of the pre-show match when you were at ringside, and then of course you all came out at the end for a big brawl with the Govan team and Vicious Lads and Leighton Buzzard. It was quite mad to think that you were his last community pro wrestling match before he went off to Japan.
He's smashing it out there, and is it the Japanese in, isn't it?
BBJW, I think that's the promotion in Japan he's working with.
So yeah, he's smashing it out there. It's kind of surreal because I trained with Leighton Buzzard back in the GPWA days, so it was kind of, for me, it was kind of like a moment, if you know what I mean. You know, you get moments in wrestling. For me, it was kind of like a moment that I'm in the ring the last 4-5 minutes of the match, and it's me and Leighton Buzzard. To me, it's probably one of the best in Europe right now. And I'm bestowed the privilege to be in the ring with him in his last match in CPW for the last 5 minutes or so, and to take a good beating as well. So, all good.
But no,
I was just saying, it was one of the kind of moments in wrestling, like obviously my debut and like my Pollock. I've got a whole, because I was born in Pollock when we done the Pollock show. And you get moments in wrestling that you kind of go, and that was meant for me, basically. So that was one of the moments to share the ring with Leighton Buzzard for the last 5 minutes of that match.
That's what wrestling should be about. Well, it seems to be is about nowadays, is those moments, whether as a fan or as a wrestler. Was it in Deadpool 4 or 5 moments to take in, kind of thing, and to have that in your first year. You got the hometown show for yourself. You got your debut, of course. You got to reunite with Leighton for 5 minutes at the end. You got to do all these things and be a focal point of a lot of shows as well, because the pack used to be it's the big overarching bad that kind of replaced Thatcher's cabinet a little bit in CPW. So you're quite a integral part of CPW. Is it anything you would have imagined that first day you walked in and Ravy Davy turned to you and went, "All right, John, with that first year, has it exceeded your expectation? Is anything you thought would have happened has happened?"
No. Like, it's succeeded it in so much more. To be fair, when I first went in, I thought, I'll just give this a bash. Again, see how I feel, see what I can do. But as the months went on, and obviously I got my debut, that's when it kind of lit a fire under me and thought, I just kind of reflected to myself and thought, I can actually do this. And then obviously the year I've had, debuting in different companies, the hometown show, the thing with Leighton, even Wrestling Davey, you know, these are all like moments, as I said earlier, these are all moments that I didn't think I would get, but I've got them and smashed them. I think in my own head, I don't know if people say different, but I'm not one to take people's opinions on sometimes, so.
I mean, not only that, you said you faced Ravy, but I think if I remember results right, you also got team with them in some sort of way. You end up briefly teaming with them, so that must be another one you kind of got to tick off.
So I was part of the Govan team in Pollock. It was meant to be me and Ravy in a street fight, Erdross and Monstrum decided to talk some smack about my hometown. I tried to give them a beatdown. Obviously, the two of them got on top of me. Ravy came out, made the save, and we teamed. We got the win. And then I shook his hand as I was leaving. He cut a promo, obviously, about my old hips, my old legs, my old back. Did I want to go and rest it? Or did we want to give the people up all a street fight where they came to see? So we had a street fight, and I got the win there as well. Canadian destroyer on a chair.
Of course. Why does that not shock me? Is that your first and only Canadian destroyer? Was it?
No, I had two of that match as well. David's the only one I've Canadian destroyed. So we've done a student SmackDown show, obviously showcasing the students in the school and stuff. And I was in a six man, and I hot and move on in that as well. So Canadian destroyer is one of the moves you look at it and you go, I'll never be able to do that, but it's just I've actually hit it three times on Ravy. So
it's one of those moves where you look at it and go, the comments on like your internet, on your internet, how old am I sounding? we go, oh, it's all the other person doing it. And I looked at it going, he's still flipping himself back and spiking himself in the head. I'm not going to be in the queue to do that. Thank you very much as well. So, you know, but no, it's still one of those moves there. I still love it.
Just to look at it. I think the first time I seen it, and I'm probably going to sound timey here, the first time I seen it getting done was Stevie Boy. He obviously done his destroyer, and I thought, what the hell is that? Obviously, it's been done before him, but I hadn't seen it done. So, I quite like doing it. But for that day, I was calling it the Pollock Destroyer, because I was obviously doing it in my hometown.
Of course, that's the rules. I don't know why people don't pick up the Irish whip. It should just be the Scottish whip, and you know, just rename everything for it to be local. That's money right there. So before we go into things like into the future, you know, and favorite matches, etc., we'll get my stupid questions out of the way first of all. Which, yep. As I said, you've listened to the show, you know what's coming, so I'm hoping you've thought long and hard about it. First up, what's your favorite dinosaur?
T-Rex.
Nice classic. No frills, which, like I say, that's what's kind of what JTT is all about. It comes in, destroys, leaves. Easy.
Yeah.
And the other one is, what would win in a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
I'm going to say two sheep. And don't ask me why.
Oh, no, I agree with you. I've said it. This question has been, must be 100, 200 episodes now that I've had this question asked. I've asked this question, and I'm still, nobody's convinced me otherwise. It's still two sheep. You know, numbers in itself.
Numbers game. That's why I'm in the pack. Come on.
Exactly. Numbers game. All works. All goes together. So there you go. There's my questions out the way. You've listened to enough episodes now. You finally got to answer them on the show. So moving forward then. You've had a probably phenomenal first year, because it's not even completed yet, because it debuted in April, so there's still technically 5 months of your first year left to go, with plenty to probably fit in, because there's Governversary coming up. It will have happened by the time this episode goes out. Don't know what's going to happen, although I think I may know of what it is, but we'll do that off camera. It's fine.
PAX gets something up their sleeve for the Govern anniversary. The Govern anniversary. So we have.
So hopefully it has happened.
We're going to make an impact.
So going forward then, what's the plan? Is there things lined up that you can speak about? If there's not, we can go into fancy.
Nothing yet. In terms of ambition, me and Rex have obviously, we're a tag team. Tag gold would be, I wouldn't say the pinnacle, but it would be one of the highlights in my career if me and Rex were to get tag gold. So we're going to work hard at getting that. that's in the future.
It's only a matter of time before CPW bring in some tag titles. So by this time, we'll have a women's champion in CPW. We've also got the heavyweight title. It's only a matter of time before Darrow and Big Ross will be champion for title belts. He's undefeated. The government team will be wanting something. The pack will be wanting something. Whoever's trolling around with Thatcher Wright will be wanting some sort of gold in their pack as well. So, only matter.
There's enough tag teams to tag gold in and make it exciting. Like, you've got guys that come in like Rabu and Mikey, the Casino Brutale boys. So there's enough tag teams to make that tag division exciting, you know.
Absolutely. And said ambition going forward, is there any promotions that you have an eye on? Is there a full circle thing where maybe an ICW, or is there any promotions that you've watched that you just think, yeah, maybe I can probably get there in next year, or I can work towards that booking?
Honestly, I'm quite happy wrestling for CPW and obviously APW. But there's promotions out there that want to bring me and Rex or even me down, then I'm always open for bookings.
But again, it's probably going back to that maturity thing, isn't it? It's at this point, you know, a little bit longer in the tooth, you're like, I just want to do it. I don't really care where at the same time, you know?
No, I get where you're coming from, aye, but it's not, like, I want to work for as many companies. As I say, I work for OTT, Earn Island, got on their Contenders show. Was that October? So it was. That was really good. I'd love to go back there. That was probably one of the highlights. OTT was good, really good.
Did you do gut check at all?
No, I had to actually go to work. In life taking there, I'd booked it off. Somebody phoned in sick. I had to go in, raging, £80 down the drain.
Just have to go. No, I'm fighting in front of Scott D'Amore. Thank you very much. You can poke it.
So
next time, hopefully.
Next year, hopefully. Again, I need to get a focus on. Let's see, because it's a winter months, it's cold. Need to get a focus on training regular again and go to the gym and stuff. So I need to get my focus back on that. I've been slacking a wee bit, Billy. But again, it's old age and life.
That's it. I mean, like we said, I don't know if I recorded it at the start there, but like I was saying, it's you say the winter months. If it gets dark, I'm done. I'm done for the day. If it's dark at 5 o'clock on a Sunday, I'm not going back out. Nah, done. You can
totally
get the Netflix up. I'm finished. But that's fair enough. Just trying to get yourself out there. So there's limited time for you to do it. So be as well. Get to where you can or get in many places. OTT, of course, been one of the biggest promotions in Europe still. Still one of the biggest, and even though it's Contenders, it's still an opportunity to get onto their main shows. So it's never taken anything for granted for no. Any match at the end of the day.
Any
opponents? Any opponents that you have your eye on, even if it's ones you watched initially when you got back into wrestling, is there anyone that either as a team, as just yourself, outside of CPW, that you want to tangle up with?
The Legends Never Die boys, that was kind of one I wanted, obviously, go to wrestle them for APW. Any tag team. I like to work with any tag team because you're working with different styles and different things of wrestling. So, like, I'd really like to work the Casino Brutale boys. I think I'd learn a lot for that, and obviously it'd be a good match. And is it the Freshness, Martin Steers and Romeo?
I've seen their name pop up a bit. Of course, for CPW, I think, was it Termination Z have got them?
I'd like to work them as well. So we'll see what happens in the future, but any tag team, bring it on. The pack are ready. The unwanted are ready.
Have you got a tag team name for yourself and for for Draven as well, or is it just a case you and Rex are within?
Me and Draven only tagged once. That was obviously my debut, and then me and Rex get booked as a tag. We kind of hang with, and it's just went to me and Rex. To be fair, I think Draven's kind of doing his singles thing, or he's tagging with one of the other boys, you know. So, I mean, it's me and Rex going forward. The unwanted.
Excellent. So we've figured out. We've got a bit of your journey. We know what kind of the future holds. Well, we won't know what the future holds yet for JTT the pack. We just know that they're always watching. They're always going to be about in CPW at the very least. This has been a fascinating chat. Is there anything that you thought that I would bring up or that you wanted to make sure you got into the podcast before we wrap up?
Just a wee bit about the school.
Yeah,
about that. So obviously Ravie's school, you've got an adults class, you've got a 12 to 15, you've got a 5 to 11 year old class. So I was just basically wanting to put the school over, like what he's doing for the community I govern and the wrestling in whole is brilliant. If it wasn't for Ravie opening that school, I wouldn't get back into wrestling again. So I think it's a great thing he's doing. I think next year it's going to be bigger and better. So if anybody's wanting to be a wrestler, contact Ravie Davey on his Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, or even contact the school. So, aye. And Community Pro Wrestling, get yourselves down to a show. It's, even if you don't like wrestling or you're not a fan of wrestling, when you leave these shows, you're gonna love Community Pro Wrestling and wrestling in general.
And where can people find out more about JTT?
So on Instagram is JTT_PW_1, and my Facebook is the same. Just get Facebook and Instagram. I don't like X or Twitter.
Neither do I, but it seems to be the best place I have for doing my own plugging stuff. But great, excellent. Thank you very much for being on the show. Okay. This has been an absolute blast.
Also, Governversary, 24th, 25th, get your tickets. Got to be a belter of a show.
That'll be for the Patreon, because this will come out afterwards. But if you got the Patreon, go get a ticket.
Yeah, exactly. All right, Billy.